I'm Barbara Mead. I'm one of the founders of Politics and Prose. Thank you. Along with Carla Cohen, I just was telling David that Carla always grabbed David every time that he came to talk, and so I never was going to fight with Carla about that. So, but this evening, Brad and Lissa are in Arizona for a meeting, and so I get to introduce David. David has become almost a regular at Politics and Prose because Once in a Great City is his 11th book that he's been here to talk about, starting 20 years ago with his book about President Clinton, first in his class. David was born in Detroit, and there is a Maraniss, there's some Maraniss family mythology that on the day of his birth, his father took his older brother and sister to a Tigers game at Briggs Stadium in Detroit. David's not sure that's true, but he's not going to quarrel. I also want to mention that Aviva Kempner arrived in Detroit 3 years after, a year after David was born. Aviva was 3 years old when she arrived. And I think there must, Aviva, are you here? You're here, okay. I think there must, Aviva's going to be talking later on this evening about her film Rosenwald up at the Avalon Theater. I think that there was something in the air that those years for Aviva and David when they were young, because they both got interested in biographies of sports figures. David, Roberto Clemente, and Vince Lombardi, as well as the Olympics, the 1960 Olympics in Rome. And Aviva went on to produce movies about Sandy Koufax and Hank Greenberg. All of these have entered into our cultural mainstream. David received the Pulitzer Prize for his coverage of President Clinton's 1992 campaign for president, which turned into first in his class. He was part of the Post team that won the 2008 Pulitzer Prize for coverage of the Washington Tech shootings. And he has been a Pulitzer Prize finalist twice for journalism and once for history, for his book about Vietnam in the 60s, They Marched Into Sunlight. In the acknowledgments of this book, David is very kindly expresses gratitude to his Washington Post colleagues, Ben Bradley and Don Graham, as well as many others. David is now an associate editor of the Washington Post. He's a fellow of the Society of American Historians. He and his family, he and his wife, Linda, live both in Washington and Madison, Wisconsin. I should say that David is also co-producer, along with his wife, Linda, of their son, Andrew Maraniss, who was here last year to talk about his book, Strong Inside, about Perry Wallace and the integration of the Vanderbilt basketball team. It's just a wonderful, if you haven't seen the video of it, go on YouTube and type in Politics and Prose, and then type in Andrew Maraniss, and you can watch him talking about the book. It's just a wonderful, wonderful talk. It's a wonderful, wonderful book. You shouldn't miss either. It's a family tradition to write great books. So here's David to talk about his newest book. Thank you, David.
Thank you, Barbara. It's an honor to be introduced by you, and I know what it's like to fight with Carla, so I'm sure that I can understand why she would prevail in those situations. I consider Politics and Prose my home court. I love coming here. I love books, independent bookstores, and this one in particular, and I talk about it wherever I go. And thank you for mentioning my son. I'd say that, you know, I've written 11 books, and none have made me happier than to see my son write a book that was so well received and was just such a great book. So I'm delighted.
You say you were now teaching at Vanderbilt. Tell them about your now teaching at Vanderbilt.
She is like Carla. My son lives in Nashville, so I don't get to see he and his family as much. So I started, I talked to the people at Vanderbilt University and said I'd like to come down and teach, and they said yes. So I teach there every other one semester every other year. Okay? Thank you. As for my father taking my older brother and sister to a Tigers game on the day I was born, it's family mythology. I'm going with it. It's probably true. My mother would know when my dad had slipped out to go to a Tigers game because he'd come home with mustard on his shirt. So, and he had a lot of mustard on his shirts. Another family tradition. I'm going to do something a little different tonight. I'm totally old school and a techno moron, but along with having a son who writes books, I have a daughter who's incredibly talented, and she and a friend did some videos that really amplify this book in a wonderful way. So if all works, and we've got a great technician here to help, you can hear some great Motown music and Aretha singing too. This book, like all of my books, was a labor of love in the sense that I have to be obsessed about something to spend 3 years or 3.5 years of my life writing about it.
You are about...
Okay. Yeah, anyway, if it was too smooth, it wouldn't be me. So we're going to have some technical things here. But in any case, I have to be obsessed to write a book. And this one came to me in one of the more unusual ways. I was in New York City on Super Bowl Sunday of 2011, watching the Green Bay Packers play and eventually win. And at halftime of that game, it was kind of surreal because my book about Vince Lombardi had been turned into a Broadway play, and I was actually in a bar with the cast of Lombardi watching the Green Bay Packers, his old team, standing next to Dan Loria, the actor who played Lombardi, seeing Loria also on the screen because at halftime they ran a little thing with Lombardi, with Loria playing Lombardi. And then the next thing I knew, I looked up at the screen again and I saw a commercial with an image of a freeway sign that said Detroit. And that caught my attention. And for the next 2 minutes, I was transfixed as I watched this car drive through the streets of Detroit, and these images flash of these incredible iconic scenes of the Joe Louis fist downtown, Joe Louis, the great boxer from Detroit, the Diego Rivera murals from the Detroit Institute of Arts, and then there's this incredible hypnotic backbeat, and it's Eminem, Marshall Mathers, driving through the streets in a dark sedan, and he gets out and walks into the Fox Theater, and there's a black gospel choir rising in song. And that got me thinking. Now, the first video I'm going to show deals with the mayor of Detroit in 1963, which is the center of my book, and then we'll slip into what came next.
You are about to witness the very exciting story of a city and its people. It will be an adventure that will open new sights in familiar surroundings. It is a story of a city seeking new horizons in a resolute contest with great challenges. That city is Detroit, home of nearly 2 million people. Back in 1701, long before this land became a nation, Cadillac planted the colors of France on Detroit's shore. And thus began a rich and inspiring history which has brought Detroit to its finest hour, the today of which we are a part. Yes, Detroit is enjoying its finest hour. There is a renaissance, a rebirth in the city. There's a newness in Detroit.
A question for you. What does this city know about luxury? Huh? What does a town that's been to hell and back know about the finer things in life? Well, I'll tell you, more than most. You see, it's the hottest fires that make the hardest steel. Add hard work and conviction, and the know-how that runs generations deep in every last one of us. That's who we are. That's our story. Now, it's probably not the one you've been reading in papers, the one being written by folks who've never even been here and don't know what we're capable of. Because when it comes to luxury, it's as much about where it's from as who it's for. Now, we're from America, but this isn't New York City, or the Windy City, or Sin City, and we're certainly no one's Emerald City.
City. And this is what we do.
So I'm in this bar watching that, and tears come to my eyes. I choked up watching it. Now they're just selling cars. I didn't want to buy a Chrysler. And as my wife smartly said to me a little later, you know, why are you falling for this? They're just, you know, Detroit's a mess and they're just selling cars. And you're, why are you so emotional about it? But it got me thinking at a very profound, deep level about why it hit me that way. And it's because I was born in Detroit. I spent the first 6.5 years in that city. My earliest primordial memories are of Werner's Ginger Ale and Hudson's Department Store and the Bob Lowe Boat and Metropolitan Park and Briggs Stadium and our flat on Dexter, about a mile up from the Fisher Y, where as a 6-year-old I'd catch the bus down Dexter and have to go into that Y in the freezing swimming pool and swim naked with all the other little 6-year-olds. But all of my earliest memories, the strongest memories, are of Detroit. And so that got me thinking, what should I do about this? It hit me at that level. Well, what I do is write. So I wanted to write about it. And what did I want to write about? At the time that this happened in 2011, Detroit was having difficulties. It would soon go into bankruptcy a couple of years later. But I'm not a financial writer. That's not what I do, and someone else can do that better. I wanted to write about a book that would capture both what Detroit meant to me indirectly, but about what Detroit meant to America, because it gave this country so much. I wanted to honor it in that way. And when you think about Detroit, today it's sort of the symbol of a city of ruins, or it had been up until maybe a year or two ago, and now it's starting to become a symbol of a city of hope again. But it gave many important things to this country, not just cars, you know, the big three and the other automakers that started in Detroit, but music, the incredible music of Motown, the soundtrack of my generation. Labor was really strengthened and built in Detroit, the United Auto Workers, the strongest labor union that did so much to help create the working middle class. Civil rights. Detroit was central to the civil rights movement of the 1960s, as I'll talk about later, and building that middle class through working, rising the laborers into the middle class. That's an incredible accomplishment for any city. So how do I capture that? And I realized that I wanted to write about Motown. I love music, especially that music. And so that limited the chronology of when I could write about it. Motown was founded in 1959. I wanted to capture it an early moment of energy. I wanted to write about cars, and I wanted to capture that at a time when the cars were booming. I wanted to write about civil rights, and again, so all of this came to a period of 18 months between October 1962 and May of 1964. And the book starts with two events that sort of get the threads going. One is that the Motortown Review, the first Motown tour, started in October of 1962. Two busloads of the most incredible talent you could ever imagine. Little Stevie Wonder, Marvin Gaye, Mary Wells, Martha and the Vandellas, Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, the Temptations, the Marvelettes, the Supremes, sort of the first opening act. Nobody knew whether they'd make it or not. All organized by Berry Gordy and his under-recognized sisters, who played a central role in the creation of Motown. October of 1962, they start spreading their story, their song to the nation. On the very same day, the Detroit Auto Show opened, which is to Detroit what the Academy Awards are to LA, or the White House Correspondents' Dinner, which I can proudly say I've never attended, is to Washington. And they introduced the cars that would sell more than any in history to that point, the 1963 models. At the same time, out in Dearborn and in a secret set of rooms downtown in the Buell Building, Ford Motor Company and J. Walter Thompson Advertising Agency were concocting the creation of the car that became the symbol of the 60s and liberation and sexiness and all of that, the Mustang. All of this going on at the same time. So I wanted to get those threads moving because I think that Motown and, I mean, the name Motown implies both of those things, cars and music at the same time. The other elements of the story were civil rights and labor, and all of these are interconnected, interwoven in that period of centered around 1963. The United Auto Workers, led by Walter Reuther, who I consider one of the great under-recognized figures of 20th century American social history, was not only helping bring the working class into the middle class in Detroit through the strong union, but also inextricably linked to the civil rights movement. It was Walter Reuther in 1963 who really helped bankroll the incredibly important spring and summer of 63 in the South. When Dr. Martin Luther King was arrested in Birmingham and wrote his famous letter from the Birmingham jail, and so many of his supporters were attacked by fire hoses and police dogs by Bull Connor and the racist police force of Birmingham, Alabama. It was the United Auto Workers based in Detroit that provided much of the money that bailed those people out of jail and funded a lot of the other events of that era. At the same time, Detroit had the largest NAACP chapter in the country and a very bubbling civil rights movement of its own. One of the figures who came up during that period was a reverend named C.L. Franklin, who had a daughter named Aretha, and two other daughters who could sing as well. And Reverend Franklin from the New Bethel Baptist Church in Detroit, first on Hastings Street, which is sort of the center of Black Detroit, and then later up in on the west side, had perhaps the most popular church in Detroit and was truly a national figure, so much so that in the years before that, he was sort of a flying preacher. He would fly to different cities in the South, Raleigh or Birmingham or Jackson, Mississippi, and thousands of people would fill arenas to listen to him preach. They knew his sermons by heart. He'd had them recorded on Chess records and also played on the radio. And he would bring along his daughters who would sing and several other great singers. And so it was an incredible, almost like a rock concert where people would be calling out, give the sermon of the eagle stirreth his nest. And he would deliver that sermon. In 1963, Franklin decided to get active in the civil rights movement. He was a friend of Mahalia Jackson's, who had called him and said that he urged him to do something to help the Southern Christian Leadership Conference and King. And so he decided to stage a rally, an event in Detroit to raise money for the Southern Civil Rights Movement. He was a flamboyant character, so much so that a lot of the establishment African-American ministers in Detroit really didn't want him to be leading anything. They thought he was somewhat of an embarrassment to them because of his flashy ways. But he did start organizing this event and invited King to Detroit. And the march happened on June 22nd, 1963. It's essentially lost to history because of another march that occurred a couple of months later. But King arrived in Detroit. He was greeted at the airport by the police chief, George Edwards, who was a progressive police chief who'd been appointed to that job by the mayor, Jerome Kavanaugh, who you saw in that sort of drab, typical 1960s clip about Great Detroit. Kavanaugh himself was a liberal who had essentially been elected because of the black vote in 1961, and he was determined to try to change the image of Detroit, which had suffered for a long time. During World War II in 1943, there'd been a major race riot in the city of Detroit, pitting African Americans mostly against Southern Appalachian whites who'd come up, both groups coming up to work in the defense industry. They were fighting over jobs and housing, and it turned into one of the worst riots in American history. And then in the years after that, there'd always been tension between the police force and the African American community. So Kavanaugh and George Edwards came in to try to change things. Edwards meets King at the airport, and his first words are, "You won't find any police dogs attacking you here." It was a welcome to Detroit. And from that moment on, it was one of the great days in Detroit history. King joined with Walter Reuther, marching arm in arm with him and Kavanaugh and Reverend Franklin and others, down Woodward Avenue for more than a mile from up near Wayne State downtown to the Cobo Arena. 150,000 people joining this march, incredibly peaceful, no arrests except for a pickpocket and two drunks. They arrive at Cobo Hall, and Martin Luther King proceeds to deliver the I Have a Dream speech in Detroit first, 2 months before he did it in Washington. A different iteration, some of the words are different, but it was the same, I Have a Dream. He did it in Detroit first. And we're going to show a little bit about Reverend Franklin and King here.
Whatever your mental attitude is has a lot to do with what you're going to be and how successful you are in your efforts. Now, in other words, if you think you are a grasshopper, that's exactly what you are. If you think you are too weak, you are too weak. Yes. If you anticipate failure, believe me, you're going to fail.
I have a dream this afternoon. One day right here in Detroit, Negroes will be able to buy a house or rent a house anywhere that their money will carry them. They will be able to get a job. Yes, I have a dream this afternoon. One day in this land.
Oh, here I stand.
Reverend Franklin chose not to preach at Cobo Hall the day that Martin Luther King was there. And a lot of Detroiters say that it was lucky for King that he didn't. Because he could out-preach even King. It was a glorious moment. This book is about a time of luminescence in Detroit. When all of these things were happening, the creative genius of Motown, civil rights, labor. And even then, though, I say that it was a luminescence of a dying light. People later, particularly conservative right-wingers, would blame the fall of Detroit on the people of Detroit. They would say that it was the riots or rebellion of 1967, the pensions of city workers, and later corruption of different mayors that led to Detroit's downfall. You can argue one way or another about some of those to one degree or another, but Detroit was already structurally dying in 1963 when this was taking place. It was really starting in the 1950s, the out-migration, the depopulation of the city, the big three automakers abandoning the city for other places, not really realizing what an investment, how important an investment in the city itself was to their own futures. Ironically, the freeways of Detroit were cutting through the established African-American neighborhoods, unsettling everything during that period. There was still that racial tension built up through the defeat of open housing measures, where African-Americans weren't allowed to live in a lot of different parts of Detroit. The ring around Detroit was building with shopping malls. Now, some of these issues are familiar to any struggling city, but Detroit was kind of like a perfect storm of all of those. And so that sociologists at Wayne State University in 1963, during the period of my book, predicted exactly what would happen, that Detroit would depopulate by 500,000 people every decade from then on, which is sadly exactly what happened. So the tension in the book is sort of a tension of life. I mean, it was a magical period in Detroit. You had all this creative energy going, and you had decay coming at the same time, the shadows of decay. I love to focus on the magic and creativity, and that mostly has to do with, I mean, some people would be interested in the car part of it. I do write about the creation of the Mustang, and it is a fascinating story, but I'm not a car guy. I love music more, and so the Motown part is what captured my fascination the most. We're honored tonight to have the stepson of Berry Gordy's sister, Esther Gordy, in the audience. Judge Edwards, thank you for being here. Esther Edwards was Berry Gordy, the founder of Motown's older sister. And as I said earlier, I think that his sisters are under-recognized in terms of the creation of Motown. All of them had an instrumental role in that. And Esther is the oldest of them. Berry himself said was the keeper of the castle. But why did Motown happen in Detroit then? Why is it that certain cities at certain times have this burst of creative magic? And some of the answers to that, I really tried to explore that in this book. Some of the answers are obvious. One is luck, you know, just that all these talented people were there. One is the skill of Berry Gordy and his family. Berry Gordy, who started Motown with a loan from his siblings and parents of $800. The Gordy family were entrepreneurs, and they had this fund that they set up where each member of the family would contribute to it every month, and then they'd vote on how it would be distributed. And Berry was lucky enough to get Esther to vote with him to start Motown. That's how it started. And Gordy was not just a great businessman, but also skilled at finding talent. But what were the other reasons? Well, one is familiar to people who come from Chicago or some other industrial cities of the North. It was the Great Migration that brought the oral traditions of song to these northern cities and brought jazz and the blues as well. And that was certainly part of it in Detroit. But apart from that, two other factors were key, in my opinion. One was that Detroit had all of this disposable income because the working class had jobs, and they also had single-family houses. Detroit was this enormous geographic city, 28 miles across, all single-family homes almost. And into those homes could go pianos. And Detroit had a great piano company, Grinnell Brothers Piano, which was the largest manufacturing of pianos in that era, and also had policies that would allow virtually anybody who had a salary to get a piano and pay for it over time. So that every musician I interviewed, from Gordy himself to all of the other artists and Funk Brothers studio band musicians, talked about the pianos in their homes. The other factor, which I think is incredibly important, was the school music teachers in the public schools. Detroit had excellent schools in that era, and they also had music teachers in elementary school, junior high, and high school, so that everyone I interviewed talked about and could remember their music teachers, whether it was at Cass Tech, which had the great musical tradition, or any of the other schools. When I talked to Martha Reeves of the Vandellas, she remembered the name of her elementary school music teacher, Emily Wagstaff, I think it was, her junior high teacher, and her senior high teacher. And she talked about how her senior high music teacher drilled them in the classics, the fundamentals. And he picked her out to sing opera at the Ford Auditorium. And one of the, you know, I have tape recordings of my interviews with Barack Obama and Bill Clinton and a lot of famous people, but one of my favorites is my interview with Martha Reeves, where in the middle of it, when she's telling me about her high school music teacher and the opera, she breaks into an aria on tape, something I'll keep forever. So all of those factors, I think, help explain why Motown happened then. And Martha Reeves, everything connects in this book in some way or another. A couple of years after this, the Mustang is introduced at the New York World's Fair, and one of the early videos is of Martha and the Vandellas in the Rouge plant in Dearborn, singing with Mustangs coming down the line. And we're gonna play that now. That was the Temptations' first hit, written by Smokey Robinson. He along with Holland Dozier Holland, wrote most of the great songs of Motown. That song and a couple others prompted Bob Dylan mythologically to say that Smokey Robinson was the greatest poet in America. He actually never did say it. It turned out that a PR guy at Motown contacted Bob Dylan's PR guy and said, you know, why don't we have Dylan say something nice about Smokey? So he said, yeah. So they concocted this line. And Dylan said, well, I don't know if I said it or not. I might have been thinking about Wallace Stevens, but but I'll go with it. So it's lived on. And Smokey certainly was what I consider one of the three geniuses of Motown, along with Marvin Gaye and Stevie Wonder. Little Stevie, who at age 13 during that era, I sort of compared to a character in another one of my books about the 1960 Rome Olympics, when then Cassius Clay was 18 years old and won his gold medal. And Stevie at 13 and Cassius, later Muhammad Ali at 18, were similar in that they were just sort of rambunctious kids with no other larger meaning to them, which would come much later for both of them in very profound ways. My book carries through that period of the walk to freedom and the beginning of Motown, and you start to see the shadows of what's to come, despite the best efforts of Mayor Kavanaugh and the police chief. The racial tensions in Detroit were not that easy. You know, you can't be naive about it. It was very difficult. And a month later, a black prostitute was shot and killed by the police, shot in the back outside of an establishment on John R. And that created a whole firestorm that, you know, sadly we still live through today in Ferguson and other places about what the, you know, the relationships between the African-American community and the police. Sort of an early shadow, foreshadow of what we all know is going to come in Detroit. The book ends in May of 1964, after the Mustang is released at the World's Fair. Detroit still appears to be luminescent in all those different ways. Lyndon Johnson arrives in Detroit. He was supposed to be there in October of 1962 to give a speech at the Detroit Auto Show, but that very day was the day of the breaking of the Cuban Missile Crisis. He didn't make it. Now he's invited 18 months later to give the commencement address at the University of Michigan. Actually, that invitation was first issued to John F. Kennedy, but he was gone by then, killed in November of 63. Johnson accepts the invitation, arrives in Detroit at the airport, is greeted by all of the characters of my book. Walter Reuther is there, Henry Ford II, the president of the Ford Motor Company is there. Johnson at the airport declares Detroit the herald of hope for the United States, the engine of the US economy. And then takes a helicopter over to the University of Michigan and delivers the Great Society speech. The readers, we all know what's to come, but the characters then don't. It's sort of a wistful moment of what if in so many different ways. Detroit then was so important politically that candidates for president, Democratic candidates for president, would start their campaigns in Detroit, traditionally on Labor Day, in Cadillac Square. And in 1960, John Kennedy started his campaign there in Detroit at Cadillac Square. And just as Martin Luther King, a few years later, had practiced or rehearsed his I Have a Dream speech in Detroit, Kennedy delivered a variation of his most famous line in Detroit first, too, "Ask not." He didn't phrase it that way. The ask came later in the sentence, but it was the same idea. Don't ask what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country. And as I think about that and about Detroit, you know, Detroit is, you know, the people of Detroit, and Detroit has been blamed for all of its ills by a lot of people, demonized. To whatever degree that's valid is totally debatable. But my feeling is that the time has come not to ask what Detroit did to itself, but ask what we all can do for Detroit, because it's meant so much to all of us. And I'm going to play one last.
There's an old friend that I once heard say something that touched my heart, and it began this way. I was born by the river in a little tent, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. He said it's been a long time coming, but I know my change is gonna come.
If Aretha can sing for the Pope, she can sing for us, too. I say that the key word in the title of my book is in. Once in a great city. Not once a great city, not once upon a great city. It's still a great city. Thank you very much.
Mic here. If people with questions could go to the mic, please.
Yes, sir.
Congratulations on another great book.
Thank you.
What was the status of the development of black political power at the time of your book, and where was Coleman Young at that point? Did you come across him?
Yes, thank you for asking. Coleman Young was on the horizon. He was just about to run for the state senate a year later and start his political rise. There was one black councilman out of the seven on the Detroit City Council named Patrick, and he resigned during that period at the end of the book. The black political power was just starting to flex its muscles. They had elected Jerome Kavanaugh, the white mayor, over a Mariani who was a Republican reactionary. So it was the first step. And then from then on, it would increase after that. But it was just starting. John Conyers would run for Congress the next year. He's another person in my book. Damon Keith would become a judge. So there were a few very activist lawyers in town at that moment, George Crockett, Keith, and Conyers in particular, who were starting to form the political strength of the community. Yes.
David, a week after the Watts riots, I mean, the Watts riots happened a week after the Civil Rights Act is passed, or the Voting Rights Act is passed. And then you have Detroit in 67, and you have Newark in 68, I think. And then Nixon is elected, and then it stops. Why were the riots happening in a time when there was such promise, and then the anger didn't sustain itself through the 70s, do you think?
Well, why did Ferguson happen during Obama's presidency? I don't know that there's a correlation. I think that things just build up and then explode. Perhaps, you know, some people make the argument that when expectations are increased, the frustrations increase with them. And when you have, so that's a possibility. But you have as good of answers as I do about that. It's an interesting historical anomaly or fact. But I don't know. In Detroit, it had been building for, you know, sort of like World War I preceded World War II in so many ways, led to it. I think what happened in 1943 was never resolved, and 20 years later came problems, and then 24 years later. I'm going to go back and forth. Yes, sir.
For a kid who grew up on the east side of Detroit down by the river, hello.
Hello.
I just wanted
everything in Detroit is East Side, West Side.
Yes, exactly. I wanted to mention or add an anecdote to your mention of Cass Tech.
Yes.
Because I went there and graduated from there in 1948.
Wow.
And it was a phenomenal experience in the city. I mean, we were lucky. I doubt that there was any place as inspiring as Cass Tech was to the students there. I was an art student, but the point mm-hmm. is to hook into your emphasis on music was that our study halls in that great 9-story tall building were balconies in the auditorium. And by osmosis, an art student could pick up sort of subconsciously an appreciation of classical music because down on the stage there were, depending on the period, at least a high school version of a full orchestra being conducted by a student with a instructor there. And here was all this marvelous music while you're thinking and being involved in other things, but it's coming. And that always struck me because many years later I ended up in places like London and Munich in studios like, Abbey Road. Whenever I had 80 or 100 pieces, we would do it overseas rather than here in this city. So Cass Tech sort of came back to an art student and ended up overseas.
That's fabulous. And you're not the only great Cass Tech graduate. Aviva Kempner, who's in the audience, went to Cass Tech. Diana Ross went to Cass Tech. Paul Reiser, who was the great trombonist for the Funk Brothers, went to Cass Tech. And many, many others.
And Lindbergh's mother was a math teacher there. Just FYI.
Well, Lindbergh's another matter. Yes, Denise.
Again, David, thanks for another great book. You know how it's going to end, but you make you want to turn the page to see it. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
But in the book, you talk about Detroit's bid for the Olympics.
Yes.
And there was discussion that race had nothing to do with it. And I was wondering if you could expound on it and why do you think Detroit actually lost the bid?
Thank you. Most people don't know it, but Detroit almost got the 1968 Olympics. And the decision was made in 1963 by the International Olympic Committee in Baden-Baden, Germany. And Detroit was the U.S. Candidate for the Olympics. It had been even four times before that. Detroit had a very strong connection to the Olympic movement. Avery Brundage was born in Detroit, and three of the members of the International Olympic Committee were Detroiters. So they thought they were going to get it. A month before that decision, the City Council in Detroit voted down an open housing measure by a 6-1 vote. Or no, 6-2, I guess it was. So there was a reaction in the African-American community against Detroit because of that. And some letters were sent to all of the IOC members saying Detroit can't even get its act together on civil rights. Why should it host the Olympics? Whether that was a factor or not, I think it was a minor factor. There were so many larger events happening in the geopolitically between the Soviet bloc and the Western bloc and the rise of third world nations that Detroit probably would not have received it anyway. But what fascinates me is the unanswerable counterfactual history. What if? What if Detroit had won those Olympics? Would the establishment in Detroit have been more sensitive to the problems there and have taken actions that might have limited the possibilities of the night what happened in 1967? Would the riots have happened in Detroit had the Olympics been coming the next year? Would Mayor Kavanaugh and his people responded differently to what happened in that situation? You don't know, but it's interesting to think about. And also, what would it have been like if Detroit had held those Olympics, which were really the Black Power Olympics? That's when Tommy Smith and John Carlos raised their fists in the Black Power salute, and so many other things were bubbling around. If that had all occurred in Detroit, it would have had a wholly different and even more powerful dynamic to it. So I think that race certainly played a role in everything in Detroit. I think it plays a role in almost everything in this nation, unfortunately. I think it's still the American dilemma, but I don't think it was the major factor in that specific decision. Thank you.
Well, you certainly identified an intriguing and colorful 18 months, but you've thought so much about Detroit. Could you move forward to the present and just reflect on what you think the process of regeneration of Detroit is?
Yes. There is a regeneration in Detroit. It's limited, but it's real. One is in the downtown. A lot of big investors are buying into Detroit, gambling on it. You know, they want to make money, but it's helping energize the downtown. Not just the Quicken Loans guy, but several other big corporations are really investing in downtown Detroit now. So it has an energy it hasn't had before. And even more interestingly, the area that's called Midtown around Wayne State University and the Detroit Institute of Arts is just being flooded with young people. 22 to 35-year-olds are going into Detroit the way they went to Brooklyn or Queens, you know, and they're inventing their lives there. It's cheap property. There's momentum building, so more of those kids want to go there. So artists and musicians and techies and foodies are all going to Detroit. It's kind of a place to be now. So those two things are very positive. At the same time, the Detroit is, as I said, a huge geographic area, 28 miles across. And there are wide swaths of abandoned housing and no jobs. And, you know, 10 days ago, I went to Detroit the first day of my book tour and was interviewed by Kai Rizdahl of Marketplace NPR. And we were going to do the interview in front of the flat where I lived when I was 6 years old. It was torn down. And five of the eight houses on that block were either gone or abandoned. So, and that's not uncommon in a lot of parts of Detroit. So my feeling is that, yes, you can call it a renaissance and it's happening, but until somehow people figure out how to deal with the housing problems, bringing back the working middle class, the African Americans who lost their jobs and their houses, who are the backbone of Detroit, you can't call it a true renaissance. And of course, that's a really, really difficult problem in every city, and especially in Detroit.
Thank you.
Yep. Yes, sir.
Born and raised in Detroit, Castech, 1950.
Did you know that guy?
No, I don't. We've been looking at each other, but I was starting when he was leaving. It seems to me a lot can be said about Detroit that hasn't even been discussed. I don't know if you've seen on the internet a picture of Osaka and Hiroshima today,
sure,
as it is today, and then a picture of Detroit. And the caption is, "Who won the war?"
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But the national governments of those countries, and you could say, put Stuttgart, incidentally, in that picture, really got behind the industrial power of the country and re-resurrected those cities. I mean, they're glamour cities, mm-hmm, of the world today. And Detroit, struggling, staggering, and the national government ignores it.
Yep.
And one has to wonder to what extent race is a factor in that, because Detroit is still somewhere between 80% and 90% black.
Well, I think it is a factor, and an important one. And it's one of the points of everything I've been trying to say is exactly what you're saying, sir. You know, I mean, that's why I said I think it's time to think about what Detroit gave us and what the country can do for Detroit, because it did give so much. You know, I have to confess that I didn't watch the 3-hour Republican debate all 3 hours. But I would bet my life that not a word was said about the problems of cities in that whole 3 hours. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry, I should go this way.
Thank you.
Okay, sorry.
I was born in 1962 in Detroit, and I grew up 3 miles out of the city. I gotta say, I'm really curious. What was resonating for me in your talk, uh-huh, I haven't read your book yet, is around the music and the creativity. And I have to say, from my own experience in the 70s and 80s, I had just amazing experience with jazz.
Uh-huh.
And I feel like, you know, I'm curious if you explored that with your book in terms of the birth of Motown. And also, I just want to share that my niece, who's from Detroit area as well, is doing her PhD right now on the birth of the techno movement.
Yes. I don't
know if you're familiar with that.
Yes.
It was born in Detroit.
Electronic music.
And she's really correlating a lot of the music and rhythms of jazz, Motown, techno to the beat of the industrial factory.
Uh-huh.
And she spent a lot of time with the industrial sounds and sounds of industry and how it's affected maybe people and their creativity.
Those are wonderful comments and questions. Jazz was instrumental to the creation of Motown. Most of the Funk Brothers, the studio band, were jazz musicians and great ones. And it was the jazz clubs of Detroit that got everything started. Berry Gordy, before he founded Motown, had a record store where he sold exclusively jazz. Unfortunately, he wasn't making any money off it, so he stopped doing that. And then the connection to the industrial processes. Gordy's first songs he wrote when he was working the line at the Mercury plant. And so it was rooted in the beginnings of Motown as well.
Yes, Janet Novotny. I grew up in the Lower East Side of Detroit in the 40s and 50s. We lived three or four blocks from the Chrysler plant where my dad was a machinist. And it makes me a little sad in a way to hear what you say about Detroit, because that was not my experience. My parents were sons and daughters of immigrants. We lived on a three-house street where the two other residents were what we called white trash. And, you know, but in order just to, I mean, there are a lot of other things. One of the great things about me in that period were the nuns. Uh-huh. I was raised Catholic. The Catholic schools did so much for me. I don't know if any of that intersected in your book, but it's, I think, a very, very important thing for Catholics. The nun I had in the 12th grade got me to college and got me out of Detroit, which I left in 64. I've never gone back, only to visit my family. And I've seen the city go down, and I'm really happy that things are looking up, because I did go to a Tigers game the year ago, July, with my sister, who still lives in Michigan, and downtown shocked me. It kind of made me think of Shanghai, you know, where all the huge skyscrapers. I don't know that Woodward Avenue has skyscrapers, but I've never seen so many buildings. So I have good hopes for Detroit, and that it will bring a lot of joy and wealth to people.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I don't know if it's Shanghai, but but there are cranes in Detroit now, and there weren't always cranes in downtown Detroit, so they're building, very much so.
Okay, we're beginning to run out of time, so we're going to do the two questions here and the one question here.
Another question about immigrants.
Yes.
And I'm just wondering if you cover the immigrant situation in Detroit during the period that you look at, or if it's, I know, I mean,
it's not the center of the book, but there are immigrants throughout the book. The first character in the book is a Lebanese American, a kid who grew up in southwest Detroit, not far from Rouge, and would play hooky all the time, and was there the day that the Ford Rotunda burned down. And he talks about the immigrant experience of all of the Arabs in Dearborn and southwest Detroit. There's also mention of the Hungarians in Detroit. And throughout the book, you'll see different immigrant populations. Which has me thinking about an unrelated question, but which is, maybe Detroit is a place that should take a bunch of Syrian refugees. You know, it needs people. It's depopulated. It has a large Arab population already. You know, I'm not sure about it, but I think it's an interesting idea.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
It's ironic because I wasn't going to ask the question about my family, but. My grandparents are actually both born and raised in Iraq and grew up and had a grocery store in downtown Detroit, and dad as well. But my question is really simple. It has to do with the ad that inspired the book. Did you ever contact the person who created the ad and have a conversation?
At the time, no. It wasn't really even going to be part of my book. But since the book came out, I've in Detroit, all of the people around the ad and around Eminem, actually, have contacted me. I'm hoping to meet both the voice of that ad, who grew up in Grand Rapids, the people who did the ad, and maybe even Eminem. You know, I'm not an Eminem guy, but I but I'm sort of becoming one. Everything I heard about him, he's actually a good person.
Yeah. It brought back memories when you talked about the Mustang.
Yes.
I had just graduated a year before that Mustang came out, and I went to Detroit for Easter, and my cousin had just bought it. And he rode around Cadillac Avenue. I caught pneumonia because I didn't have a coat on. I had all the windows down, and I was in bed for 2 weeks.
That's a great story. What? One last Mustang story. So, the Mustang was supposed to be a secret that would be unveiled on a specific day, the biggest marketing campaign in history. And Henry Ford II, who was the head of Ford Motor Company, his sister, who had married someone named Ford who was completely unrelated, just a coincidence, had a sort of a ne'er-do-well son, Walter Buell Ford III or something, and his nickname was Bewley. And Bewley, Henry Ford gave an early Mustang to his sister to let her experience it, and nobody was supposed to see it, and Bewley took it because he was about to get married and drove downtown and parked it outside in a parking lot. And the automotive reporter for the Detroit Free Press happened to walk by and saw this car, and all of a sudden it's on the front page of the Detroit Free Press the next day. Thank you very much, everybody.